Hello, welcome back. In this video lecture, I'll be discussing about critical size and geometrical buckling. This critical size and geometrical buckling plays very important role in design of the reactor. We discuss these two things using a theory called as one group theory. That means here we assume that the production of the neutrons, the propagation of the neutrons, and also the leakage of the neutrons from the reactor, that takes place at one particular energy, and that is the thermal energy. That is why the name one group theory. As we discussed in the previous video lecture, in order to see the self-sustained propagation of neutrons, what is important is the multiplication factor. We generally denote it by K. If that K is equal to 1, we say that the reactor is under critical state, and we see that the reaction takes place on its own, and it will be self-propagating. If K is less than 1, we call it as subcritical state. From one generation to next generation, the number of neutrons decreases. Finally, the reaction will terminate at one point. That is the one which we use to shut down the reactor. If K is greater than 1, we call it a supercritical state. From one generation to next generation, the number of neutrons increases. Hence, there will be huge accumulation of energy at reactor core, or at one time there will be an explosion because of the huge accumulation of energy. That is the working principle of actually atomic bombs. Here we define critical size of the reactor as follows. For a given assembly of fuel and moderator, for which K is equal to 1 or K infinity is slightly greater than 1, there is a definite and finite size of the reactor at which the neutron distribution, if it is established, will maintain itself. We call it as self-propagating. Number of neutrons, it will not increase or decrease from one generation to other generation. And this size of the reactor is called as critical size of the reactor. Generally, in order to determine the critical size of the reactor, we use diffusion equation. We already discussed about diffusion equation in previous class. The production plus absorption plus leakage, that sum should be equal to 0. And what happens is production adds up neutrons, whereas leakage and absorption reduces the number of neutrons. Hence, they will be having negative signs. But the leakage is given by fixed law of diffusion, that is minus d del square phi, but this is having negative, this reduces the number of neutrons, so therefore minus into minus, it will be having plus sign, and this will be the absorption term, and this is the source term, production term, that sum will be equal to 0. Now defining this source term as some sigma a into phi with this k, where sigma a is the absorption cross section, phi is the flux of the neutrons, and k is the multiplication factor. Then the diffusion equation can be written as d del square phi plus k sigma a phi minus sigma a phi is equal to 0. Now you can notice that from these two terms, this sigma a phi will be a common factor, hence you can take it outside. Then d del square phi plus k minus 1 into sigma a phi will be equal to 0. Then dividing this entire equation by d, then you can write this equation as del square phi plus k minus 1 by d into sigma a into phi is equal to 0. And taking this k minus 1 by d into sigma a is equal to some b square, we call it as geometrical buckling. That will be equal to k minus 1 by L square, where we have taken L square is equal to d by sigma a. In fact, that is equal to lambda t into lambda a divided by 3. This L is called as diffusion length, where d is diffusion constant, as we mentioned in the previous video lectures. Hence, if you substitute for that b square in the previous equation, that is diffusion equation, we get equation as del square phi plus b square phi is equal to 0. As I said earlier, this b square is called as geometrical buckling, that actually determines the critical size of the reactor. This equation can be solved for reactors of various sizes and also various shapes. applying the boundary conditions, appropriate boundary conditions, because this is a differential equation and it invites always arbitrary constants. To eliminate these arbitrary constants, we have to introduce boundary conditions, and by introducing boundary conditions one can solve this equation. But here we assume that the production of neutrons, the propagation of neutrons and the leakage of the neutrons takes place at one particular temperature or one particular energy, and that is thermal energy. That is why this theory is called as one group theory. Now let us apply this equation, we call it as one group equation. Now for this equation we will apply it for a spherical reactor. For a spherical reactor, that means a reactor of spherical shape, the appropriate coordinate system to solve this equation will be the spherical coordinate system. In spherical coordinate system, del square phi can be written like this. It is 1 by r square dou by dou r, r square into dou by dou r, plus 1 by r square sin theta dou by dou theta sin theta into dou by dou theta, plus 1 by r square sin square theta dou 2 pi dou phi 2. This is actually del square phi. If you substitute here, you get del square phi plus b square phi is equal to 0. But here we don't have to carry out with this angular part, because flux will be symmetric in all directions. Therefore, theta and phi dependence can be ignored. Only r part becomes very important. Hence, this del square phi will be equal to 1 by r square into dou by dou r. Now, since there is no r and theta dependence, you don't have to use partial derivatives. So one can use total derivative. We can use 1 by r square into d by dr, r square into d by dr. This gets simplified to d2 by dr2 plus 2 by r into d by dr. If you substitute for del square phi in this equation, then that is in this equation, we get d2 phi by dr2 plus 2 by r d phi by dr plus b square phi is equal to 0. This is the one group equation for spherical reactor. To solve this, we assume that phi of r is equal to some, we substitute this variable y of r by r. Then this equation simplifies to a homogeneous linear form, d2 phi by dr2 plus b square y is equal to 0. This is the simplified form of equation phi. And for this, general solution will be y of r is equal to c sin br plus d cos br. Here c and d are the arbitrary constants. We can eliminate these arbitrary constants by applying the boundary conditions. See, the first boundary condition that we apply is the flux is finite everywhere, including at r is equal to 0. At r is equal to 0, we assume that there is production of neutrons. Hence, here, when you put r is equal to 0, automatically you can see that this term is 0. We assume that the flux should be 0, y of r should be 0. If you put r is equal to 0, sin 0 is 0, so this term goes to 0. This term will go to 0 only if d is equal to 0, because cos 0 is 1. Cos 0 is 1, automatically we have to put d is equal to 0. So from the first boundary condition, we put d is equal to 0. If you put d is equal to 0, we get y of r is equal to c sin br. Now the flux will be equal to y of r by r. Therefore, phi of r will be equal to c by r into sin br. This is the flux that we get, but still c is the arbitrary constant. In order to eliminate this second arbitrary constant c, we have to use another boundary condition. That boundary condition is at some linearly extrapolated boundary, that is at r is equal to r naught, again we expect the flux is equal to 0. What is this r naught? This r naught is equal to the radius of the spherical reactor plus this linearly extrapolated distance, that is 0.471 lambda t. If you substitute that value, that is r is equal to r naught, we expect the flux to be 0. Therefore, this equation, this phi of r will be equal to 0 at linearly extrapolated distance, that is at r is equal to r naught. If you put that c by r naught sin br naught will be equal to 0. This is like sin theta going to 0. We know that sin theta becomes 0 for when theta is equal to an integral multiple of pi. Hence, we write BR naught is equal to n pi, where n is an integer, taking the values from 1 to 3, 1 to infinity. Hence, B will be equal to n pi by R naught. So, if you substitute for B, then we get phi of R is equal to C by R sin n pi by R naught into R. As I said, n varies from 1 to infinity, but the lowest value of n is very significant, and the lowest value of n is equal to 1. Hence, if we substitute the lowest value of n, we get B is equal to pi divided by R naught, because we know that B is equal to n pi by R naught. If we put n is equal to 1, we get B is equal to pi by R naught. We get the critical size. It is a spherical reactor. Hence, the volume of the reactor will be equal to volume of that sphere, that is 4 by 3 pi R naught cube. This R naught includes the linearly extrapolated distance also, that you have to remember. Hence, it is equal to 4 by 3 pi into pi by R naught whole cube. Therefore, you get 5 by 4 by 3 pi and pi cube, pi to the power of 4 divided by b cube. You can notice that this 4 by 3 pi to the power of 4 is a constant. Pi is equal to 22 by 7. If you substitute for this pi and if you evaluate, this volume of the spherical reactor or the critical size of the reactor will be around 130 divided by b cube. Now you can notice that critical size of a reactor depends on this buckling factor, that b will decide the volume of the spherical reactor. Similarly, one can use this one group theory to calculate the critical volume of various shapes of the reactors. One can apply it for cylindrical reactor, rectangular types reactor, etc. You get different values of V. This is the case for a bare reactor. So, we discussed about bare reactor. Suppose if the reactor is surrounded by some reflecting materials like graphite, beryllium, etc., this will scatter back the neutrons to the core part. This actually covering the core with a reflector will help us in three important aspects. First thing is, this reflector saves the fissionable material. That means you can save the fuel by covering the core with the reflector. In addition to this saving of the fuel, it also reduces the size of the reactor. So, you can reduce the critical size. And also, it increases the number of neutrons. As a result, there will be increase in the average power output of the reactor. That is why we always cover the core of the reactor by a suitable reflector. And that reflector should have certain properties. We will discuss those properties in the next slide. This is how, you know, the flux variation takes place. Suppose, say we have a bare reactor. In that bare reactor, the flux variation will be like this. At core, the flux, at the edge of the core, the flux will become zero. And it increases towards the center. At the center, the flux will be maximum. But if this core is surrounded by reflector on either sides, or if it is surrounded by the reflectors, say you have a spherical reactor, if it is surrounded completely by a reflector, then you will see that the flux in the core part enhances. It is lifted up, you can notice. This saves the number of neutrons, this saves the fuel, this also increases the output power of a reactor. And also this reduces the critical size. Hence, we have lot of advantages in covering the core of the reactor with a suitable reflector. And that reflector should have these properties. It should have high scattering power. It should scatter back all the neutrons as much as possible back to the core. The scattering mean path should be low as possible. It should be of low atomic weight, and it should be naturally a solid material. And those materials like graphite, beryllium, they have these properties, and such materials are used as reflectors for the cores.